I'm here in Tazour, and it's a part of Tunisia that is south of Tunis. But what I love about this is that the city is known for its brick design and the great market, which they call the souk, and it's where people come to shop for shoes, for pottery, for dates of all things, and I love dates. And what I also love about it is the fact that men come here and they sit in the cafes and they communicate, they congregate, and it's a celebration of life. This is the tallest minaret in Tazour, and it's in the heart of the Medina. You know, there are so many narrow walkways in the Medina, and it's a great place to meet people. A horse and carriage is a popular means of transportation, especially for the tourists. You'll find beautiful carpets and wall hangings in the Medina. The cafes are a focal destination, and it's where the men come out and have tea and share conversation.
It's good.
You know, when I think of dates, it's not dating a girl or dating a boy or whoever. It's really about the dates of Tunisia, and this is really my favorite. I mean, I can eat these day and night, and they're dessert. They're very special, and you know, olive oil and dates are the best here in Tunisia.
We stopped, in fact, for an incredible Bacchanalia lunch at the Oliver's Palace Hotel, and it was incredible. I mean, there was such a great variety of different dishes. This decorative interior is filled with two large, colorful vases. This is a dining and relaxing experience next to the pool, where we could just hear the birds and the bees. The brick is a traditional Tunisian dish.
Different kind of meat in there?
It's tuna and egg.
Yep.
Every dish is so fresh and colorful, and it's so appetizing.
We are in the Grand Mosque of Kairouan. It has another name, Sidi Al-Kuba Mosque, which is actually the oldest mosque in North Africa. So it was built in 670 AD. And this reminds us actually the ancient periods. I mean, if you go to any Roman fort or Roman monument, especially ruins that exist now, it's very similar in the simplicity of the monument, no decoration, no stucco, no tiles, because 7th century was still that typical Arabic civilization. Well, this mosque is divided into three main parts. We have the minaret, which is the highest minaret in Kairouan, about 60 meters high, and this is the entrance of the minaret. Of course, it's locked, and inside there are about 137 steps. Of course, the minaret had different roles. Number one, it was for religious role. It was a kind of the highest monument in the town. The muezzin could use, so maximum of people in the town could hear the prayer call 5 times a day. And the second role was military, so as a tower, it was a watchtower, of course, to watch all the region around any town, but especially the city of Kairouan. So the architecture itself, we can divide it into three parts. The entrance, which is made of these marble blocks, as you see, three marble blocks that remind us the Roman monuments. You see the acanthus leaf here around. So this proves that these three blocks were brought from different monuments, abandoned monuments or abandoned towns in Tunisia. And the second is these sandstone blocks that form the basement. of the minaret outside and inside. It's a whole basement all round. And another proof we have here that it is from Roman, or the blocks are brought from Roman and Byzantine monuments in Tunisia. We don't know which town. We have here this Latin inscription, and we can distinguish here the name of a Roman emperor, Antonini, which is Antonine, that lived in the 2nd century AD. So what we know is that these blocks come from a monument built in the 2nd century AD, but we ignore which monument and which town. For this one in general, as you see, it's the same inscription, but it is upside down. For a simple reason, the Arabs didn't care. The small thin bricks that form actually all the rest of the minaret, and those are the Arabic bricks, we can say, that are still produced now in Tunisia, especially in Tozeur, the southwest of Tunisia.
Welcome to the wonderful world of travel. I'm John Haggins. I'm here in Tunisia. Tunisia is a very special destination. It's on the Mediterranean, North Africa, so it's very exotic. Great olive oil, great dates. I love dates. I'm here in Karawan, and this is the Kasbah. I've always wanted to say, take me to the Kasbah. You know, this is so exciting to be here in this historic place in Karawan. Tell me about this mausoleum.
The main town in North Africa, main Muslim town, was founded in 670 AD, and it was the town of Karawan where we are. And immediately the city of Karawan became the Arabic and Muslim heart of all North Africa. The Arabic influence in North Africa, it was the Andalusian influence.
Andalusian,
it's about two-thirds Spain, right? Two-thirds of Spain, we can say. So the Arabs invaded Spain in 711, exactly, and they stayed there for a long time until 15th century after the Reconquista. They influenced the culture, the, we can say, daily life, the agriculture,
and the
economy
art.
In
and
North
the art,
Africa.
As we see
and
here
the art, that's the most important, actually. This monument is 17th century monument, of course, and this is an example of the Andalusian influence with the colors. First, so you can see the blue.
Right, which is here, yes.
Four classical colors.
Colorful desserts are so appealing and delicious. In this world of extraordinary places, extraordinary places, I'm glad there's Tunisia. Tunisia is a very special destination. It has the desert, the mountains, and the sea, and great people. We were here for the Sahara Festival in Duz, and there were camel rides, horses racing. My God, it was just, you know what I always say, that people make a difference when you travel, and I love it. Until next week, I'm John Haggins, the Globetrotter. I hope to see you then. Remember, get up, get out, and travel! I felt I could have stayed here forever. Look forward to seeing you next week at another great destination. Until then, so long for now.